Hello again. We're now at episode number 10. It's entitled, Is Change Gonna Come? So I have, long story short, I am recording in my sunroom today. So hopefully the sun will cooperate and not make me look like a ghost. So let's get going. All right, is change gonna come? And the title simply comes from the standpoint of every 20 years, we have changed our judging system, changed from 1951 to 1971 to 75. We changed, now we changed again in 1993. So the expectation is we're now 20 years into it during this period of time, and what's going to change? So we'll see exactly what happened. All right, so a little bit of catching up. I haven't talked about this a lot, but periodically throughout history, ICJC and then SCJC is going to discuss a little bit about should we, in order to create more excitement at the international level, should we toy with the idea of having some sort of non-random assignment of judges, or not of judges, of competitors? And we've had contests where we get back-to-back, we get some high-profile quartets, or especially choruses. People are all excited. And then when choruses are all spread out, there's not excitement. And so we recognize that, and can we add more excitement? But the moment we suggest that it could be done purposefully, then everybody screams, it's fairness and all the rest of this. So we will look at this two or three times during this upcoming decade. And again, not take any significant action towards that until what we had in 2020, which never happened. All right. One of the things that I recognized as an incoming judge and then watching candidate classes come in is oftentimes we lose 50% or more of the candidates, not because they weren't capable of doing it, but they got lost in the system. They weren't encouraged along the way or whatever it might have been, but we lost people along the way. So as a category specialist, I implemented a new system whereby I wanted to get all of my judges across the finish line. Candidate judges. And so I put Al Fisk in charge of that, and it was nicknamed the Wrangler, and he did a great job. We had well over 80% of our candidates make it across the finish line. So we implemented that sort of system in all of our categories going forward, and it's proven to be very, very successful. And then the other thing that I recognize is when I came in 1998, I had judged four contests, practice judged four contests, and I felt like I was ready. But you go to category school and you go, I don't know if I can really do this. And so watching judges try, or candidate judges coming into the system after I had certified, I thought, you know, they need that confidence that says, yes, I can do this. So when I was category specialist of music category, secured permission that in the very final contest season before category school, if they were doing a great job, they could be assigned a division contest as the certified judge. And it proved wildly successful. So we implemented that across all categories, and we did that going forward in the new decade. And then the events team is now looking in the year 2006, 2007, we're starting to look at the background of what our videos look like. And rather than having the shell or a blank curtain, how can we improve the look? And so that is going to be an ongoing thing. Every year it looks a little different. So where do we leave off? The categories were maturing. So we left off, we were in the decade from 2001 to 2007. And in team building, we talk about the model of you form, then you storm, then you norm, then you perform. And our categories were all in a state of somewhere between norming to performing. So we'd gotten through the initial stages of storming and adolescence, and we were really figuring out how to work in this new world. And then penalties were reintroduced in 2007. And that really took us back into a tremendous amount of storming. And it truly, in that fall of 2007, it was chaos. And it took several years to address the upset that that system put into play. So let's look forward into what's happening now in this last decade. So SEJC, there's a lot of focus on improving transparency of the judging system. So what information is shared is more category. This is how we want, you know, these are the directions that the categories are going, and that's shared, but that's about it. What's happening behind the curtain is a black box. It's a mystery to barbershoppers. Why are decisions made the way that they're made? Well, we're just telling you this is the decision and here's our high level rationale, but we're gonna work on that. We're going to, as much as we can, pull back the curtain and let you see what's inside. And we'll talk about some specific things that help us move in that direction. There are a lot of complaints about Saturday night evaluations. So I mentioned in a previous episode that the events of 2001 and 9/11 were very, very important because it impacted our ability to travel easily to make assignments. So in an older time, we used to have Sunday morning evaluations and a judge could pick up their bags at 11 o'clock and they'd get to the airport at 12 and they could catch a 1 o'clock flight to get home at a reasonable time. And now judges are getting home, if they have Sunday morning evaluations, they're getting home very, very late, if not on Monday. And so that's not fair or sustainable. So we push towards, and frankly, competitors would show up with one person Sunday morning and set a tape recorder in front and say, just tell us what we need to work on. And that's not the model that was intended either. So all of the evaluations are now pushed to Saturday night only. There's no Sunday morning evaluations. And that creates havoc in the district events because after the Saturday night finals or show, quartets want to go sing the rooms and they're having to be pulled to go evaluations. And and this is only going to grow in intensity during this decade. And unlike the previous decade, in this decade with four schools, we are going to limit the number of judges to 40 maximum. We're going to adhere to that. There was one exception, but other than that, we've always met that 40. And then for the first time in our history, the invitation to come to category school in the past has always been, you must perform, you must pass all of your tests, and you must be one of those top 40 judges. And so judges would go to school and not be certified. And in this case, in this decade, we are now going to eliminate that criteria. If you get an evaluation, it says you are going to certify, and it changes the whole dynamic of category school. It's now much more collegial, and it's a much better learning environment. I'd mentioned it at least once, in the chorus contest at International, there are always delays, and the board and Harmony Hall are pushing on SEJC to investigate this. And there's a lot of push towards time penalties to restrict the time. And SEJC is resistant in trying to solve this problem. And this continues on, and we will see how this got resolved. The pendulum on judges conferencing. So I mentioned in the last episode that in the finals, quartet finals in Denver, Larry Clemens told the judges in the pit, if you need to talk about a controversial performance, you know, feel free to go do so. And so that really was opening Pandora's box. And, you know, once the box is open, you can't close it back. And so judges are experimenting with how much conferencing is appropriate. And in its early days, it was intended to send a message to say, yes, we heard something that was controversial and we need to discuss it to make sure that we're all on the same page, make sure that the competitor is not unfairly hurt by one judge thinking it's a problem and another one thinking it's not a problem. But then it kind of takes a life of its own. So it's going to, pendulum's going to move in all sorts of different directions throughout the decade. And then finally, technology in the pit. And so in 2012, as I was chair, we looked at a whole world of new technology in the pit, from sending numbers in on a keypad and the use of tablets and uploading numbers to the cloud and all the rest of that. And one of the challenges was that the software that the CAs used is very old, takes a lot of maintenance, held together with paper clips and bubble gum and rubber bands, and it fails quite a bit. And so ultimately we will move to new software that will be available at the end of the decade, which has a lot more functionality and a lot more ability to adapt as judging changes, either the number of categories or the number of judges or an absence judge or, you know, this, that, or the other thing. It can absorb any sort of change going forward. We do approve in 2012 the use of tablets as opposed to paper for judges to take notes. But this is not a mandatory thing. It's completely optional because a lot of people, frankly, don't want to deal with the tablet and writing and all that. They're comfortable with paper. But we do have a couple of judges today who show up with their iPad or Kindle or whatever that is, and they take notes appropriately, and it works for them. And in concept, we approve the use of technology, but there are two major problems that we have to deal with. The first and biggest problem is Wi-Fi availability. Now, every year we forget what Wi-Fi availability was like, but back in 2012, it was not universally available anywhere that we went. And oftentimes we would have to purchase it if we wanted Wi-Fi availability. So if you go to a hotel, you know it's really expensive. We can't justify that. The other is security. So if we're sending information, we're putting it on cloud, the ability for people to hack in, you would think nobody who would care, but people care. And so the thing with technology that we discussed is if it's January or July 2nd of 2012, something doesn't exist, but it might on July 3rd of 2012, tomorrow, the problem might be solved. So in general, SCJC just says, we're open to any sort of technology change that will make us more efficient, but we've got to solve certain problems. And so I think within this next decade, it will look very, very different. All right, so let's go along a given timeline. So in 2010, Harmony Hall and SCJC have been in discussions about the effect that contest has on choruses, the long-term effects. And so we see choruses go to international, qualify, and feel obligated to go to international year after year after year. And if you look at their chorus size, men on stage start shrinking and their quality levels start shrinking. And so we're genuinely concerned about that. We don't want contests to be obligatory. Contest should be an option that you have to help you improve, to participate in a way that you want to participate. So with a lot of reservations, we went to the board making a recommendation that choruses at international compete every other year. There were a lot of people there who spoke in favor of leaving it as it is. And so after a lot of discussion, the board did not accept that recommendation. And thankfully, just after that, Great Northern Union Chorus came out very publicly and who had been international medalists year after year after year, came out and said, we're not going to go to district anymore, or not anymore, but we're not going to go when we're eligible to go. We're going to go do other things. And it really set a model for the rest of the society. And pretty soon after that, the vocal majority said, yeah, we're going to lay out for a year or two. And other choruses started saying it's okay to lay out. And so the problem resolved itself such that now choruses can determine, yes, we're going to go again, or yeah, let's take a year off and we'll regroup and do some other things. So it all worked out. But that was our solution at the time. And we also were looking at the Swiatalline model, which when you look at how many A-level choruses they have versus how many we have in the chorus sizes, we were just saying, you know, this is a viable option for us. But that's the history behind that. Unbeknownst to me, I was going through some notes, Steve Jamison, who was chair at the time, went to the board in Harmony Hall and suggested that we could improve our fiscal situation in some of our districts by only having one contest a year. It was rejected at the time, but we're going to come back and revisit that topic in a couple of years. There was a lot of asks by competitors to say, is my chart contestable? And so I was music category specialist at the time, and I was just simply tired of fielding all of these questions. And so Don Gray, who is a longtime arrangement judge and music judge, he was just had retired from the category as judge emeritus, said, I would love to help out in any way. So I gave him the reins of being the focal point for anybody that has questions about their contest material to send it to Don. And so that has worked out wonderfully. The committee still exists. And so that solved a huge problem for us. I spoke in one of the episodes that that in 1976, Jim Richards had done a statistical study about should we change our scoring systems and had made some recommendations. 20 years later, Ron Black had asked me, prior to me being a part of the judging system, to evaluate and say, should we change our scoring system? And so the one addition that I had in my recommendations is I proposed a way that we could evaluate how a judge performs in the pit when they're scoring on a weekend, because that's where it really, really matters. And judging a video at category school in an artificial environment is not the same as being live, and how do you score over the contest weekend? And so I, as category specialist in music category, I had implemented my own suggestion with the music category, and we sent it out to the judges and said, hey, this is how you perform during the weekend. And so it became a very useful tool to identify certain scoring behaviors. So what might that scoring behavior be? A scoring behavior might be, I score with everybody else really consistently until I get into the A range, and then I'm very stingy with my points. Or it could be that I get really happy with my points. So we could see that. You could see, does a judge get fatigued over a weekend where they're scoring pretty accurately at the beginning, but then over time it starts declining. And you can see these things if you're looking in a particular way. So I introduced that with the music category, and then in 2010, we adopted that for all categories. One of my least favorite moments in judging was at the international finals lunch break. Mike O'Neill came up to me right before they went on and said, hey, we got this idea. Would it be okay? And I thought, sure, why not? Now, I wasn't the person that was supposed to make that decision. That was Steve Jamison, his chair, but I was the asterisk judge. I was in charge of the pit from a mic test perspective. So I said, sure, why not? And so they sang one song, and then they had all of the eliminated semifinalists come up and sing in front of the mic. So it was a great moment, except it turned out to be disastrous. So what happens at international is we have two rounds of quartets. We had the quarterfinals, we had the semifinals, and pretty much you set the levels, and they're set for those two rounds. But then we had the chorus contest, and the soundboard changes, and then they change it back for the quartet finals. So you go back there and you say, is everything set correctly? Yep, you're walking through the hall. It sounds pretty similar, but the hall always changes because you have more and more people coming in, and how you listen changes throughout the week. So lunch break sings their first song, and everybody's like, that's cool. And then we had the parade of quartets in the second song, and everything's all right. First quartet out is Men in Black, and they sing, and the judges can't hear because it is so incredibly loud. And when they got done, judges were like, I can't score that. I have no idea how they sang. So it's one of the few times in history where the judging panel forced a competitor to come back. And frankly, from my seat, they sang better the second time than they did the first, which is usually pretty hard. Usually your first shot is your best shot. So that was what happened there. But it was noteworthy at the time because it was a rare event. But certainly in 2010, the biggest issue at International was the performances of ringmasters and to a lesser degree Round Midnight. The song selection of those quartets created a tremendous amount of controversy. And so not unlike Roger Payne in 1999, who created the style examination committee, I was requested by the board of directors and Harmony Hall to ask the question, can music judges adjudicate new material that doesn't follow the typical barbershop songs that we hear? And so we had a committee of people from, it's probably all right, to this is bad stuff. And the committee did a lot of study about those performances and came back with some recommendations that we adopted. But certainly in my 40 years of being a barbershopper, those performances were probably the most controversial of any at that time. All right, in 2011, a program was implemented. It actually was conceived in 2010. During the quartet semifinals, Bill Biffle got up, who was society president, got up to the microphone and he said, well, I'm going to be the MC for the quartet finals. So my front row seat in the middle next to my wife, Lillian, is available. That's the best seat in the house. And I was in the judging pit, I was in the front row center, and my immediate reaction was, no, this is the best seat in the house. And I looked down at the end of the table and there was one spot available. And in my mind, I said, if somebody wants to give Harmony Foundation $1,000, I'll sell my seat and go sit down there. And so in that was born the idea of best seat in the house. And so we started in 2011 in Kansas City. And so basically, if you were, you could bid to win a seat down in the judging pit, and you could either judge along with the other judges, but you were sitting at the real tables. You were sitting inside the judges who were actually scoring the contest, or you could just sit there and enjoy the contest, whatever you wanted to do. So we pushed this down at the district level in 2013 to help raise money for the district as well as Harmony Foundation. And it was a great tool because what people could do is, you know, people that are never going to be a judge could actually see what does it sound like? What does it feel like down here? What are the judges doing? And we would have people go with the judges, whatever the judges did, going back to the green room or talking about performances. They were there and they were part of it. And you would think, well, gosh, that's going to be a problem. What if? We had one minor issue in all the years that we ran that program, and it was a minor issue. So overall, it was a huge success. It's no longer a formal program, but the districts are able, if they want to sponsor it, SCJC is cool with that. All right, in 2012, I become chair of contest and judging. And one of my platforms is to create more transparency in contest and judging. I truly do want to pull back the curtain and let people see what's going on. And my attitude, as long as we're not talking about people, and once we make a decision, I'm fine with opening up as to why we made decisions. And so one of the things that we did was leveraging technology at the time. Blogs were popular at that point. Created an Ask the Judge blog. So you could write in, hey, I have a question for a judge, if it was performance or presentation or singing or music. We had judges who would watch the blog and they would respond appropriately. We have a lot more harmonizer articles going forward. And as I mentioned before, the best seat in the house was part of that transparency. We are willing to allow you to sit in the judging pit, and you know, we have nothing to hide. And they could, if they wanted to, they could look down and see a couple of the scores if they truly wanted to. But there was kind of the honor system, and that was always complied with. So it turned out to be a wonderful program. And there were a lot of committees. I always like to joke, on January 1st of 2012, I did nothing on January 2nd, you know, things happened. So we launched 10 committees. and with these committees pretty much were all focused, there were two main focuses. One was reducing the cost of judging. It was very clear to me that if we didn't take a proactive stance on the costs associated with judging, we would work ourselves out of a job because districts can't afford it. But then we also were looking at all of the elements that could improve the judging experience with respect to the competitors. One of the big problems that is being presented to me is the choruses continue. We have continued time delays and all sorts of other issues. And so the events team, we decide that we are going to ask the chorus, how long are you going to be on stage? How long is it going to take you to get set up? There's no penalty. There's no shame in saying we're going to be on for 20 minutes from start to finish. But what that allows us to do is build a schedule that is real. Because if we book a certain amount of time and we go over, then the stagehands get paid overtime. And in some cities, it is expensive, prohibitively expensive. So we've got to nail the amount of time on stage. And the other thing that it does is if a chorus is going to be take up 20 minutes and we've only booked a 12-minute slot for that chorus, the chorus that's behind them is cooling their heels because they thought they were going to be on stage sooner. So this way we can actually let people know you are going to be on stage at this time. And we're actually, for the most part, pretty close on this. So this was a huge step forward in managing. Now, what the audience doesn't know is we think there are delays, but we're actually, for the most part, by and large, on time. So that was part of the solution on that. And then the other thing that I was, you know, I am a barbershop nerd to the nth degree, and I look at my score sheets and I want to know every little detail, like many, many people out there. And so one of the frustrating things is, you know, when you hear the results and you're sitting in the audience, you're going, okay, when do we find score sheets? Well, it's now 2012. We can upload the results. So my goal is the moment that the CA has announced the results of the contest, the information is uploaded immediately. It took us a little bit of time to develop that, but we're now getting pretty close. So unless there's some sort of problem, we get it within minutes. 2013, there's a lot that happens in this year. So in 2012, I went to the board and I said, we've got a few choices that we must make. One of those choices is to do nothing. And if we do nothing, then we're headed for some serious financial issues associated with judging and conventions at the district level. Talked about you can redistrict. And I put together data that showed for districts that have certain membership numbers, how the number of competitors, the costs, and all of this. Eventually, the board decides that we're going to allow districts to choose whether they want to have one convention or two. And so in 2013, the board approves the proposal that we make. And that fall, Rocky Mountain District and Illinois District are the first two districts that eliminate their spring contests. And both of those had explored how do we co-share a prelims. Rocky Mountain had done that a number of times. So SEJC approves the concept of having video contests. So there was nobody that said, hey, we want to have a video contest. But we recognize that the day could come when we can't be physically in the same spot for a preliminary contest, but we want to send in our video for score only and advance ourselves to the next level. And so we approved that in concept with knowing that there's going to be some issues associated with that, but the concept is fine. And it turns out that that was quite fortuitous of that of us to do that. So that's been used in some of the collegiate contests and even some division contests. We've accepted video. And then obviously with the pandemic going on, we're looking at, okay, video qualification becomes very, very real for us now. So that concept got approved in 2013. Probably the biggest thing that impacted the competitors was we approved the variance program. And I'll take a couple of minutes to talk about how that all came to be. And so when I first became a judge, you know, there was no sort of thought of, you know, could a judge change a score? And over that next 12, 13 years as a judge, I would see, you know, for the most part, you get it right. You know, within a few points, we'll call that right. But every great once in a while, a judge will score it either really, really high or really, really low compared to everybody else. And when you compare scores at the end of the contest and you're way off from your other judge, you talk about it and you go, yeah, probably the right score is in the middle there. Or, you know what, I was too punitive or I was too generous. It could go in any direction. But I had experienced that as a judge. And I went, there's got to be a way that we can address this in a live setting so that the competitor is not suffering because of a score. And I had seen firsthand where a low score kept a competitor from going to the next level. And it's heartbreaking. And when it's the competitor itself, then, you know, you go, well, there's a lot of mixed messages there, but sometimes a judge just simply misses it and there's no recourse to fix it. And so I propose the idea that should a judge change their score and sent that out to the judging community. And I said, I want a committee of people that explore that question. Should a judge change their score? And on that committee, there were three people that were neutral and three people that were opposed. There was nobody on that committee that was in favor of it at the start. And I gave them a season of contest data and I said, analyze it and come back and give a recommendation. Didn't have to say how, it was, should we? And so 6 months later, the committee came back and said, yeah, we should, including the three people that said we shouldn't at the beginning. So there was enough evidence to say, there's enough contests where we get these scores that are different that we should take a moment and think about, is that the right score or not? So then the next 6 months was, how do we do this? And that was a different committee. And then the next 6 months was a pilot program where judges practiced how we would change scores. And I will be very honest with you, most of the judging community at the start was not in favor of the program. And even when we approved it, there was not tremendous buy-in, but it was like, okay, we'll do it. And by the fall, after we had implemented it, they saw the value. And what was truly remarkable to me was that the competitors immediately said, this is a great thing. This protects us, this makes sure that we get it right. And so it was a huge program. We amplified it a little bit in 2014, and then ever since then, it's been in place. We approved a concept that a member of a quartet can be replaced between prelims and international. So in prior years, up to that point, whoever competed at prelims in the quartet, they had to be the ones singing on the international stage. And if you look at the Swellheim model, they're allowed to replace one member. And our window is shorter. Instead of 4, 5, 6 months, we're only 2, 3 months. But nevertheless, things happen, and there's legitimate reasons why we would want to replace a member. They either sick, we've even had people pass away, unfortunately. But that is now available. One of the interesting things to me was in June of 2013, I was teaching at a Southwestern District school, and Phil McShann, who's a music, one of the music leadership, one of the musical leaders of the vocal majority, sat me down and goes, "Kevin, you know, I've been competing for a long time, and let me tell you what's like. You guys go to category school." Category school's coming up in late July. And he goes, "And then in the fall, when we compete, the judges say, well, this is what we decided at category school. And so we're letting you know now after you've competed." He goes, "It'd be really nice to know before we competed what you guys decided." And it was like being a hit over the head with a 2x4. And I said, "You're absolutely right. We don't tell you the decisions that we made." So we made a mandate that whatever decisions that were made at our category school in 2013 that would affect competitors, we would post them and let the membership know that these are changes in directions of where the category is headed. And so we've done that ever since. And so again, the idea of transparency, even though that was a dream state, it just never occurred to me that that was what was really going on. One of the things that was a passion of many of us is that as technology has advanced, we used to have the old videotapes, and to socialize those is very costly. And now with the world of YouTube and recordings, we can take recordings and relatively cheaply post them to the internet within a judge website, and now we have a library. So we begin work on our judge video library, and we have, I don't know how many videos in that now, but it's a lot. And you can search it such that if you have a contest where you have certain levels of competitors, for example, if I going to judge international, I can just create a playlist from certain choruses that are at the international level, and I could specify it from 85 up if I want to just train myself on listening for that. So it's very flexible and very powerful. And then in full disclosure, I am one of those who have defended trying to avoid having a rule dealing with time penalties on stage. And so the board is just hot and heavy. We need to implement some sort of time penalty. And Harmony Hall is also on board with that because it's impacting the length of the contest. And when that happens, it becomes an expensive proposition. There's a lot of pushback from competitors who are getting pushback in the pipeline, wanting to get on stage and compete. And so it's a very serious problem. The new tradition chorus in 2007, we had a huge delay. They set up this beautiful stage with this Gershwin, I don't know how to describe it, but a huge grand piano in the back. And it took forever. And it turns out that where they thought things were going to be weren't. And so they were searching on stage as they're trying to get ready to construct their set. Things aren't where they thought they were. The circus set by the Alliance in Toronto took forever. And so there's a lot of pushback after that about how long it took. It took well over 20 minutes to construct the set. And so I watched the video. They'd created a video of how they were able to put that set together in a matter of minutes. And so one of the things that happened was, yes, they had practiced it and they got it very, very quickly, but they underestimated how long it would take to go from the stage backstage to pick up another piece of material. As part of my chair responsibilities, I walk from the judging area to a bathroom, because if a judge has to go to the bathroom in the middle of a contest, I need to know how long we're going to tell the competitors, okay, we're backed up 4 minutes. So I knew how long it took to get backstage. It took over a minute to leave stage to get backstage, a minute. And so they had planned on just a matter of seconds. And so again, people didn't know until they got to the stage in the contest. Salem, different issues where the set was just long. And nobody is going to complain about a set if it's successful. And so nobody complains about time if you sing for 12 minutes. Okay, if it's great, we don't care. If it's not so great, then we care and we want time penalties. And so there's a lot of setup issues as we were digging through the data. And we had just a ton of one-offs, but we had very many successful performances that we would have eliminated had we implemented a time penalty. So what we decided to do is have chorus manager walk-ons at international. So if you were a competitor pre-1994, if you went to international, there were chorus walk-ons where you as a chorus would walk onto stage at the international, you would see what it looked like and get a sense of what was there. But when we changed to the present categories, we eliminated that. It's just a time constraint at the international level to funnel all of these choruses. We've gone from 16 up to 30. There's just no time. And so we decided to have a chorus manager walk on. So what they would do, what they still do if they're still having it, is at a certain time, you could go to the venue, I think it was Thursday morning, and at 9 o'clock, you would have a walk on. And so Hank Pivarnik would take you through, here's where your chorus comes in. We're going to stage you here. Then we're going to take you over here. And then we're going to line you up and we're going to take you onto stage. And then we'll take you off stage. This is where you'll go for your pictures, all of those sorts of details. And then we bring them back on stage and then they can just inspect the stage. And the very first year we did it, there were people with tape measures. And they're just going to town, looking at the stage, confirming it is what they thought it was. And so, for example, they send you all the dimensions of the stage, but you can't really appreciate it until you're on that stage. So one thing that happens at the international is those little risers, they've got a little bar at the bottom to increase stability. Well, if you were counting on the ability to slide something underneath the risers, it's gone. How much room do we actually have behind the risers? All those sorts of things you can't appreciate until you see it. So it worked great. And that was continued for a number of years. Evaluations for the first and only time at international for eliminated quartet quarterfinalists. Now, the benefit of evaluations is for education and so and getting feedback. But at the international level, you've had a lot of coaching, a lot of knowledgeable feedback. So the reasoning to have evaluations is pretty much, or not to have evaluations is pretty much there's just no time. But the way that international was laid out in 2014, we actually made some time and we notified the quartets ahead of time. In case you get eliminated in the first round, after the contest, you can sign up for a 30-minute slot. And if the judge you want to talk to is available, you can sign up for that judge. And so the competitors who were eliminated, who took advantage of it, loved it. The problem literally is having rooms in order to be able to do it. and that has been prohibitive since then. So we have not done it since then. But competitors loved it, and we did get that feedback. An important moment, and I've mentioned the context of this before, is that when we have penalties associated with category descriptions, nobody really reads the category descriptions. We're lucky if they read the rules, but nobody reads the category descriptions. So I read the rules. I don't see anything wrong with what I want to do. I do something, I get a penalty. Oh, it was buried somewhere in the category description. So drew a line in the sand. We said, if you break a rule, it's a penalty. If it's an artistic choice, then it may or may not impact the performance, but we should know what you're going to get penalized for in the rules. And so there was some trimming down of the things that the music category had in place, and that was all back in the category description. It might or might not impact your score. The one thing that happened, though, is presentation used to have the electronic enhancement penalty, and we elected to send that over to the singing category. And the pure reason for that is that as technology advances, this little device could one day help amplify your voice. And so we wanted to make the singing category kind of responsible for adjudicating any sort of enhancement that might occur as opposed to the pure voice, and presentation didn't want to be encumbered with that. So that was why singing got that. One of the things that had happened to me a long time before that was an awareness that our category descriptions were way too ponderous and people really didn't understand what we were judging. And I was coaching a group chorus one time, and I went to their evaluation. And the judge said, have you ever read the category description? And my immediate thought was, it's too long. Why would I ever read it? You know, it makes sense that we should be able to understand something pretty quickly if it's important. And at that moment, what I realized was category descriptions are a wonderful judge training tool, but from a competitor perspective, they're not written for competitors, they're written for judges. So we pushed to have more understandable language available for competitors. So up on the website, it would say, you know, the music category is the song and arrangement as you perform it. If you want more information, click on this button. So you click on that, and then it would be a one-page document of a synopsis of what the music category is attempting to do. And then if that wasn't sufficient enough, then you could drill down into the category description. So we did that for all three categories. So that was helpful so that people could really understand in a nutshell, what exactly is this category doing, and get as much information as they wanted. So everything in the Las Vegas contest was going along swimmingly. And so one of the things that I had committed to after the 2013 contest and pushback by the board is that I would walk backstage and watch every competitor load in. And so the moment chorus number one chorus is done and the lights go down, I would get out of my seat as chair and I would walk backstage to stage right. And I would watch the chorus load in. And because there were lots of things that would happen, a bus would get delayed. And so you're sitting there and you don't really know, are they waiting to get on? Are they back there? So I just wanted to have firsthand knowledge. So I watched every chorus get on stage and everything is going flawlessly. Even with bus delays, it was all swimmingly well. And then we had the GNU set, and GNU sang second to last. Nashville chorus was after that. And they did a Winter Wonderland set. And at the end, they shot off a streamer cannon. And the streamer cannon sent streamers everywhere, up into the light standards where we could not access them. Snowballs were being thrown and hitting things on the stage, off the stage, and it was a true disaster. And we elected, after a lot of discussion with Dusty Schleyer, who was the director of the final chorus, that we would continue on with the contest. But in their video, you can see streamers hanging down in the video, and that's where that was from. So at that point, the straw had been broken, and I became on board with the idea that we would have staging penalties on props and timing. And so we examined how long it would take for a chorus to load in based upon its size, and we gave them some cushions so they could put in some simple staging. But if they were going to build a set, they had to build it within a certain time. And one of the remarkable things is, no matter how much they built it, it took no time to get it off stage. But we implemented times for quartets. And if debris is left on stage, if it's more than a minute that it takes to clean up, then that's a penalty. So when I proposed this to the board, I told the board, I said, we're just going to be a little draconian right now. We're going to allow the pendulum to swing way too far. And then once we become comfortable, we'll allow the pendulum to swing back a little bit. So far, it has not swung back a little bit, but I'm sure at some point we will relax things a little bit. In 2015, to qualify for international, there's a little rule that says if your district qualifier doesn't meet the target score, and it's been 76 for many, many years, as long as they score 65, your top group can go to international. We raise it to 70. And in the 26 years of contest, only one quartet would not have qualified for international. So we just said, let's raise it to 70. You got to hit a 70. We're spending a lot of time discussing out of district quartets. And we don't want to restrict out-of-district quartet competition, but we want you to go to your district. And so a lot of districts are upset because certain quartets are leaving the district to go. They can't make their own, or they say they can't make their own district prelims. And so that's a negative for the audience. And so we reach a compromise where if an out-of-district quartet scores the target score, they go to international, regardless of whatever happens. But if they don't score the target score, then whoever scores at least a 70, the top quartet is the one that qualifies. And so that was a compromise that seemed to work at the time. In 2015, one of my worst nightmares happens. The judging software essentially dies at the end of the finals. So one of my jobs as chair is to quote unquote bless the results. And literally all you do is you turn to the head CA and go, are the results right? And he goes, yes. And then you go, okay, I bless them. That's really all that is. And so they're having problems. And so there's a printout that has a list of the medalists. And all it says is the international champion is Instant Classic. And that's all it says. And there's nothing more about who's second, third, fourth, and fifth. And so we're scrambling, trying to verify, are our scores really, really, really correct? And so we verify, yes, they're really correct. Instant Classic won, Forefront was second, and whatever else happened after that. And so we go up to the to do the announcements, and we make the announcements. And of course, you got to remember, back in 2012, I want results posted as quickly as possible. Well, we don't have results. We have nothing. And so Eddie Holt is working for BHS and saying, do you have results? Do you have results? And so I go to the CAs and I go, is there anything that we can give as a temporary stopgap while we get this problem fixed? And so they said, well, we got this file here. And I looked at it really quickly and I said, okay, I think that'll work. So we gave it to Eddie. And about 30, 45 minutes later, I hear this rumor that Instant Classic really didn't win. Forefront really won. So of course, as chair, I'm just in sheer panic mode. But what happened is as you read that particular score sheet, Forefront had won the first two rounds. And the way it looked like Forefront had really won the contest. Now, it wasn't true, but that was my worst nightmare realized. So we got it all resolved. There's a picture somewhere of Chris Buechler. The whole arena there in Pittsburgh is taken apart, except for Chris Buechler is typing away at his computer. It's pretty priceless, but that was the tipping point that we had to fix the software. And we were also looking at an international judging certification program. So again, this is not a new thing. How do we expand out? And the problem with our current judging system, if it's a problem, is that we really require people to educate. That's the primary goal of judging. It's not to score, it's to educate. And that really happens on site. But we wanted to help the world. If you scored these videos this way, then you're scoring as good as any other judge. If you're identifying the major issues, you're doing as well as any other judge. So turns out that this didn't really take off, but again, we were looking at this. So the need is there. All right. One of the things that everybody picked up on really, really quickly in Pittsburgh was that our scoring levels were dramatically higher than they were in previous years. And that was simply because we raised the ceiling. So in previous years, if it was music, just barely above 90 is a gold medal performance. And for singing, definitely 90 is a gold medal performance. And going back to your category descriptions, it says a 90 is a mid-A performance. And what we were saying for all these years is a 90 is an A-plus performance. So the bar was raised the scoring ceiling was raised. And so judges were able to use a little more real estate in separating out quartets. Now you might say, why? And the reason is if you use those 10 points from 90 to 100 and others don't, you have significant impact on the results of the contest. And so everybody deserves to have, all the judges deserve to have the same amount of influence, and the categories deserve to have the same amount of influence. So we raised that level. And then most significantly in our history, women will be accepted as applicants to work towards certification. And in going through my notes, what I didn't realize was that less than a year before, we had discussed the issue, but we discussed it through the filter of, do we need to have more people available to judge? Because we were having some certain categories were low in their judge numbers to sustain themselves. And we brought up the topic, should we certify women? But we didn't put it through the filter of, is this the right thing to do? What's the opportunity that we gain by having women being certified? We didn't look at it through all the filters. We just looked at it from a survival perspective. And we didn't need that to survive. But at the SCJC meeting in 2015, we sat down and we discussed, 20 years from now, will women be certified as BHS judges? We all agreed, yes, they will be. We said, what would have to happen in order for that to happen? We all said, I don't know. So we decided we would go forward with having women being certified. Now that's a policy that we could not adopt ourselves. That would have to be a board decision because it clearly states members, which at that time were men. Everyone in Harmony wasn't even, it was just barely in its infancy of concept. And so we had to have board action. So they approved that in January 2016, which was fortuitous because 2 years later, everyone in Harmony is rolled out and we have women as applicants and judges. So we were able to meet that timeline. The other thing that happened in 2015, busy, busy years, is presentation category, we're going to change it to a new category called performance. And that little graphic on the lower right-hand side is really what triggered the decision. Now, if you've been following all of these, you know that from the very beginning, the stage presence category was concerned about entertainment value. And even into the early days of presentation, entertainment, Trepto came along, relevancy. Are we relevant in the performance world? And so I saw this graphic in December of 2014, and I was watching. It was about the effect of cell phones and how we hold our head and the stress that it puts on our body. As you lower your head more and more, how much stress that is. And I thought, we've been taught to perform differently than is healthy for us to sing. And so I put the question out to the judging community, you know, is this a problem? And so at our SCJC in 2015, we discussed this issue, and singing and music said, we would love it, except, you know, what is presentation think? Presentation said, we would love to change. We want to be more adopting of all sorts of different types of performance styles, but we're kind of trapped in our paradigms right now. So we made the call, we're going to change to a different category. And one of the concerns that the board raised and many members raised, some judges raised, is why do we have to change the name? And it's very simple. If we left the name the same, then you would say, well, last year I scored an 82 in presentation. Now you're saying I'm scoring a 76. I haven't done anything different. Why am I scoring so much lower? And simply the name change resets expectations about what direction we want to head. So that was kind of it in a nutshell. But a lot of us are struggling with, you know, can we adopt these different aspects of performance from other genres? Can we bring them into the barbershop style? All right, this is in the category of, I don't remember when this happened, but these things happen that are important. At the international level, competitors can choose their lighting on a song by song basis. So I could have as a chorus, I could have a blue for one song, and then the next song it could be green. And that's gonna be cool. And that happened. We added stage right and stage left microphones. So that was a big deal. We discussed long and hard for a number of years about, is that possible? And it's not ideal, but it's good enough to at least allow us to expand our performance opportunities. And then for a number of years, we've had the ability for a person to call the video cues. So you can say, okay, for this particular set, go over to stage right. All the action's gonna be over on stage right. Now, in 5 seconds, I want you to go to stage left. And so, you know, if you've been at international and you're in the cheap seats and way in the back and you can't really see what's going on, the video is everything. If you're at home watching the webcast and you hear people laughing and yet what you see is not funny, then you're going, what's going on? So that's the reasoning behind that. All right, we are done with this episode. And so we have one more to go. And so we're gonna review the last set of years, 2016 to 2020. And then I'm gonna kind of do a recap and a kind of looking into my crystal ball, which is not an official crystal ball anymore. I have no knowledge of what SCJC is talking about. I can only guess. But we'll talk about perspective and where will we head in the future. Again, this video series is free. any donations that you want to give, if you feel that this has been worthwhile, give.barbershop.org/preserve. All of that's intended for the saving and digitizing of our archive histories. And then any new information that you might have, please contact me at my email address. And my goal is collecting all of these things. There might be a final article kind of catching up after the last video, the next one. Or who knows what, whether it'll be a follow-up video after that, just kind of saying, hey, this is a really cool part of our history that we missed. So we will see you one more time. Everybody stay safe out there.